My name is Christoph Windhäuser. I'm working for the company ThoughtWorks. We are doing software engineering, software development. At ThoughtWorks, I'm the head of artificial intelligence. And I'm happy to talk to you today about one of the really exciting topics, I think, in the field of machine learning and artificial intelligence, which is assistants and chatbots. And I would like to give you an overview about what is the status in the industry, what is achievable, what is not, what are the limits, some of the experience we made with developing chatbots to our clients. So here you see one of our chatbots we have built internally. I later will talk more about this, a chatbot for vacation management. So in my talk, I'm looking into a brief history of chatbots. Actually, maybe it's surprising for some of you, it's a pretty old field. Even 1950, 1960, the first chatbots have been built with some really astonishing results already. Then giving you a brief overview what kind of chatbots we have built in our company. And then we dig a little bit deeper into the architecture of chatbots. So how actually a chatbot looks like, which components are working together. Then one of the really important topics we think if you're designing chatbots, it's not only technically, but it's also a question of design. Sorry, before we are looking into different development frameworks, because you are not developing a chatbot from scratch today. There are a lot of frameworks out there which you can use. So we are looking into that. Then we go into designing a chatbot, and like a graphical user interface, a chatbot is a dialogue, has a dialogue user interface, and it's really important to design a chatbot like a personality or a persona. Then another pretty interesting topic is how to test chatbots, which is really important if you want to apply or use chatbots in your company in a productive way. Then one thing when you develop chatbots and you have to adapt them to the changing world, changing behaviors, new topics, it's important that you adapt your chatbot, that you continuously improve it, change it, retrain it, and then we are using continuous delivery for the development of chatbots. And then at the end, a summary, and of course, hopefully, I'm sure we will have time for more questions. Let me just give you a very brief introduction what ThoughtWorks is. We are a company of more than 5,000 technologists and practitioners, more than 25 years on the market. Our field of experience is software development and software engineering. And one of the founders of the Agile Manifesto, Martin Fowler, is still with us, is a colleague of us. So we have people who worked on continuous delivery, continuous integration, microservice architecture, DevOps, all this kind of stuff was also not solely invented, but we really contributed a lot for the development of modern software architecture and software development. We are spread around the world. We are more than 40 countries in 40 offices, 15 countries. In Germany, we have offices here in Munich, in Hamburg, Berlin, and Cologne. So more than 2,200 people in Germany. And the headquarters is in the US. We are not only writing software, we are also writing books about this and articles, and these are some of the books employees and colleagues of mine at ThoughtWorks have written. One you might know is our technology radar coming out twice a year, and it gives a very good overview about what is the actual status of different tools and technologies. Maybe one additional point, we really love to use open source software. So we are not a system house for SAP or IBM or other big vendors. We build our software mostly with open source tools and components. But now, that is enough about ThoughtWorks. Let's now jump into chatbots and let's start, when has everything begun? And maybe some of you know this, probably most of you are not old enough to have been there at that time, but this was basically the first chatbot, or what we now call chatbots. This is the software program ELIZA, and it was programmed by Joseph Weizenbaum in 1966. So that is more than 50 years ago. And it was actually a very simple program, but it worked very efficiently. It looked for keywords in the text input, and it mimicked or played the role of a psychologist talking to a person, very intimately and very personally. You see, for example, here is a live screenshot of what Eliza can do. There are still implementations around which you can find in the internet, so you still can play around it with it. And although it was a very simple software architecture, very simple stuff, it was really effective, and people liked to use it, and they really got really immersed by it. So Weizenbaum told in his paper when employees of his lab working with Eliza, they wanted to close the door because it was so privately, the conversations they did with this software, that is really crazy already with this small piece of software. So that was really today we would say that was the start and the beginning of conversational software and chatbots. Yeah, today you probably know and noticed chatbots are all around the place. These are just a few examples to let you know that in the messengers like Facebook and Google, you can chat with all the celebrities like Robbie Williams or whatever. So this is done by bots where you can chat with them. Hi, I'm WeBot. This is actually a serial attempt to do some psychological conversations with patients. So that is really used and researched in this area to talk to patients who have depression or something like this. And it seems to help if these people are not able maybe to talk to humans, but they can talk to chatbots. And another funny example on the right side is in London, there was a chatbot helping people to prevent parking tickets. So helping them guiding through the process of complaining. And they saved a huge amount of parking tickets, which could not been then filed in London and New York. And a very funny thing, this is very recently, I found on the internet here June the 12th, that software engineer was a bit annoyed by all the chats he got by his girlfriends. So he wrote a chatbot to answer the chats of his girlfriend. And apparently the girlfriends didn't notice. She was just a bit suspicious because suddenly his boyfriend was replying immediately, and they said, well, that is weird. Suddenly he's replying all the time to me, and then she found out that this is a chatbot. So I don't know if this is a true story, but anyway, it is a funny story. Yeah, and lots of more stuff is going on in the area of natural language processing. So if you are in that field, you probably know all that. But in the research fields, really exciting things going on at the moment in research of natural language processing, dialogues, question and answering, and this kind of stuff. And we can predict that this research will go into the field of chatbots and will improve the capabilities and the performance of chatbots very much in the near future. So on the left side, you see, maybe you heard about this OpenAI transformer tool, GPT-2, which was trained. It's a huge transformer with billions of parameters, and it was trained on a very heavy text corpus out from the internet, so purely English text, but curated text, gigabytes of text. And it is able to, well, it was trained to predict the next words, and that was the function, and it is able to generate phrases and stories. So for example, if you put in here a story, you see the input, in a shocking finding, scientist discovered, blah, blah, blah. You see the output, that this tool is actually creating a story and just writing a story which actually makes sense. It's perfectly right from syntax and writing, and it's kind of a fantasy story. So that is really stunning what you can train and when you can get out of this. And another similar example is BERT from Google, also recently published in March this year. And this is just the leaderboard of the Squad competition. Squad stands for Stanford Question and Answering Database, where there are articles from Wikipedia, for example, and then there are questions, and the bot or the software has to answer these questions. And you see the human performance on that is exactly match. EM is 68 points. So I think the percentage. And you see Bird now already overachieves slightly the human performance. So we are here very close to human performance in a couple of language tasks. And this is status of the research at the moment, but this is really promising that this probably will find its way in new products and new chatbots. So there probably you can expect a lot more and better chatbots in the future. Just an overview what kind of chatbots we have built with our clients. One example is here the Manchester Airport in Manchester, UK, where the chatbot helps people to guide through the airport, find their gates, places, restaurants. You can do valid parking, for example, a couple of different tasks. And this, as you see, was done with Google Dialog Flow. Later we will look into these frameworks. That is another chatbot. Later I will talk a little bit more about this. That was an experiment internally where we wanted to try how far can we push chatbots, what is really possible with them, and want to learn what is really important. So this is a chatbot, and it's still in production in our company to get vacation requests. And all the workflow for getting approval and checking how many days I have left and public holidays days in the different German Bundesländer, etc., is taking into account. So even this simple stuff of I want to get some vacations, handling this request is quite complicated if you look into the details. Yeah. So that was a very good experience. I will later talk a little bit more about this. This is another chatbot we are using internally where we try to work with our first level support. So simple IT requests are answered on a first level with this chatbot. And this is last but not least an actual project we are working on in Germany, in Cologne. This is the company Questback. Questback is doing surveys for other companies like employee satisfaction surveys, customer satisfaction surveys, performance surveys in the HR area, feedback services, etc. And we have built a chatbot who is asking the user, where do you want to have feedback on? And then he's selecting the right questions and actually building individual or tailored questionnaire or a survey for this client just by language input output. And this chatbot is integrated in Microsoft Teams. So already today, the chatbot name is QUBIE, like Questback QB. You find it already today. So if you want, it's the simple version is free of charge. You can install this and then you can get feedback surveys to your teammates in Microsoft Teams. So that is was this stuff. Yeah, but now let's look a little bit more into the architecture. So how is the chatbot actually working? What are the different components you need to make this run? And I found this in a textbook, and I found it quite interesting. This is a general first version of chatbots. It was very famous in the 1970s. It's a dialogue system, and it's called the GUS system, and it was built for flight reservations. And I don't know, if you're a little bit more older, then you maybe have heard about this. It was really all over the scientific press. And you see here on the left side a nice dialogue, how this works, and it looks quite natural, so that somebody is booking a flight. I think here is from San Diego, and he's asked for the date, for the time, arrival, departure, etc. And the way this is working, this is the so-called frame system or frame-based dialogue system. And frame means this type of thing, booking one flight is a frame, and a frame consists of different slots. And all the chatbot is doing is try to fill these slots. So the slots for booking a flight is the origin city, the destination city, the departure time, departure date, arrival time, arrival date. Yeah, and these different slots have different types. So for example, of course, the origin city has the type city. Only city names are allowed as input. And that is actually what the bot is doing. He figures out, okay, that is the right frame here. The client wants to book a flight. So now I have to fill these frames. I have to look for that I get the origin city. So I try to spot keywords in the text. For example, I want to fly from this kind of stuff, and I have to spot a city. So I have a long list of cities, so I know what is a city, and then I spot these keywords, and then I try to fill these frames with the right types. And then I can ask questions until I have filled all these frames, and then I have all information, and I can double check with the user and telling this, is this what you want? And then I can book the flight. That is the general principle how this this dialogue system works. And it is 1977, so it's a couple of years ago, and nothing really has changed that, since that. So in principle, chatbots today working with the same way of working like here. And what is interesting, I have put an aside from the original paper here. So GUS, or GUS, stands for Genial Understander System. That's a funny name. And the author said, this is intended to engage with sympathetic and highly cooperative humans in an English dialogue directed towards a specific goal within a very restricted domain of discourse. And this already names what are the restrictions here. And because it was at that time not really commercially really successful, because you need somebody who is highly engaged and sympathetic. So you really have to help the system and tell exactly what the system wants to hear. If you are losing your patience or you are a bit annoyed by this, then of course it screws up. So it will not work. And it is restricted to very restricted domains of discourse, like booking a flight and nothing else. In general, this is still true today. So that is also a problem of chatbots still today. They are restricted. They cannot talk about everything, of course, but quite restrictive. But with, we will see with machine learnings, we have a wider area, and the engagement and this sympathetic, it's a bit looser now. So you can freely talk to the chatbots today, and the chatbot will find out at least the intent, what do you ask about, or what you want to do. And this is another. This is then the general architecture of such a GOS system, and it's still valid today. So you see on the left side, you have an automatic speech recognition. So this is when you work with actual speech. If you're working with text, like messengers, then this will not. This you can skip that. So you recognize different phrases. You can recognize several phrases at once and have a probability what is most likely and less likely. Then you have the spoken language understanding. So you distill out of this what has the user said. For example, he said leaving from downtown, or it could be leaving at 1 p.m. or arriving at 1 p.m. You're not really sure. You have different probabilities. Then you have this language understanding token, so these three possibilities. And then you go into the dialogue state tracker. And this is, you know, where you are. So what was the history of the dialogue? Have the user already said what he wants to do? And maybe you are just missing a time, or you're missing, you have just asked for a time. Then the depart time is might be more probable because you have asked about this. So that is the history of in the state you are in. And you match this to your state, and you see here the filling up of the different frames. Here on the right side, so you know from downtown to airport, this has a certain score, and maybe you have several of these alternatives with different scores, and usually you choose, of course, the one with the highest score. And then you have a dialogue policy. Based on that, you generate the next phrase, what you want to say. Maybe it is another question or is a confirmation. Have I understood correctly that you want to do this and that? You go into the natural language generation, so you create the natural language, the text, and then you have at the end a text-to-speech module where you actually create the utterance, what the bot then is saying to the user. And then the whole cycle starts from the beginning. So that is the architecture of in principle of this GUS system, and this is the architecture of a modern state-of-the-art chatbot. This is the chatbot based on RASA. RASA is one framework here from Germany, from Berlin. I later will show you other frameworks, but the cycle is everywhere the same. So this is not with spoken text input, this is with written text input, so with a chat platform, but in principle the same thing. So that is here, the use case here is that the user wants to get some vacation, has a vacation request, and the first question he has is, how many vacation days do I have left for this year? So that is the text he's putting into the chat platform. Here in this case, it's based on Google, but this doesn't matter. And the first thing you have is an intent classifier. So you have this natural text sentence, and the bot has to figure out what is the intent, what does the user really want from me. And here in this case, he clearly recognizes annual leave left. What is how many days I have left for annual leave left. So that is a class of different utterances. And you can define a lot of different sentences to ask for this. Yeah? For example, do I have, what is the amount of days I have left for vacation today? Or tell me the days I have left this year. Or these are different sentences, but they all mean the same. They are all the same, what we call the same intent. Yeah, and this is the training of the bot. Later we will see this, that you train these different utterances of the client and they all should be mapped on the same intent. So you have the intent classifier. Then dependent on the intent, you have some entities. These are the slots you have to fill. For example, if you want to book vacation, you have to fill the slot from when your vacation should start and when should it end or how many days. In this case, you only need for which year. And this is here very simple because you are asking today, so we assume it is 2019. Yeah. So you only can ask for the days left for this year. It does, other years make no sense. So here it's very simple. You put in the intent is still 2018 because that's an old slide. Today it would be 2019. Yeah, so you have the intent recognition. Then you go to your dialogue model. And this is the same as what we've seen in the slide before. Depending on the state where you are in your dialogue, you generate the next action, which can be another dialogue, so another question or a confirmation, whatever, so another utterance the bot is saying, or also some actions to some external states, external systems by an API. So here in this case, we know the intent is to get the days I have left for this year. I know the year, so I have all frames are filled. I know what I mean, or the bot knows what to do. He has all the information, and he asked an external system here. This can be an HR system where the actual days per employee are saved via APA and get the number back. And the system says this employee has 12 days vacation left for this year. So you can take 12 days. So that is what is the action resolver is doing. They are resolving these kind of actions, get the result back. And then you have again a natural language generator who generates a text, who says, okay, the answer should be you have 12 days left. Building this together, and then either you put it directly on the chat platform as an answer, or you have a text-to-speech system so that the bot actually is telling this you with acoustic speech. I have put in some little symbols of neural networks or brains here, and this should show you in what of these things you usually or today machine learning is used. And really, almost all the frameworks are using machine learning now in the intent classifier. So this is not a classic, as in former days, keyword matching and so on. This is almost all the time is done by neural networks. So this can be done by Word2Vec, for example. Word embeddings usually is done by this LSTNN, so recurrent neural networks. And this really works pretty well. So you get a high recognition rate here. Up to numbers of, say, maybe 100 intents. So that's usually what you have, maybe a little bit more, but not huge amount, not thousands of intents. Yet usually you can restrict maybe much less than 100 intents. For example, for this vacation stuff, we had 20, 30, maybe up to 50, if you say hello and greeting and some fun stuff additionally to this. And we saw some more complex bots for clients, we had up to 100 intents. And this generally works pretty well. That works very well. You can do neural networks for the dialogue models, but this is very tricky and doesn't work very well actually today. Usually these dialogue models is still done by decision trees. these are deterministic, and you say exactly, I'm in state this, and I need that information, so I generate these kind of next questions, and then I'm in that state, etc. So you have a state model, and you have a decision tree here. That's the usual technology. That is deterministic, but you know exactly what the bot is doing in any situation. And you always can jump out, and the bot can say, sorry, I miss it, or I cannot answer your question, so let's start from beginning. So there are tries to do this with recurrent neural networks. LSTDMs is here the technology. RASA is, for example, doing that. The advantage of this is that you get some generalization. So you don't have to train everything, every possibility, like in the decision tree, where you have to define every possible move and branch and actions. So you can generalize about your training set. But you know that for recurrent neural networks, you need a lot of training amount. And in the case of dialogues, you don't have much training material. So there are not many ways to tell this or say these dialogues. There's usually one way to have a dialogue. Maybe you have another way, but you're already on intent level. So you are not on natural language level. You don't have all these variations of speech or patterns, etc. So usually you have very low number of training examples, and then the training of recurrent networks don't really work very well. So you can, of course, put the learning rate very high, but this is then overfitting, and you basically burn this decision tree into your recurrent neural network. So that is a decision everybody has to do. So we tried this, but the experience was in a lot of cases it worked quite nice, and even you get some generalization. But sometimes the bot just screw up and is doing some unpredictable replies, and you cannot really jump out of this. You have to need a command where you really can start from zero, delete your score or the situation and the state where you are. Action resolver is usually is a lookup into a table or a list. What do you have to do? Natural language generator usually also is just a table. So when I want to generate this text, this is the text I put out. And you can have several examples, and then randomly you choose this or the other so that you get some variety. And the bot is not always saying it's in the same way or the same words, so this gives it a little bit more a natural flavor. But this is usually very simple, just a lookup table. I put still here a little brain on this, because in particular for acoustic language speech output, you can use neural network to make the speech much more natural. So there is some work. So there for this you could use neural models. Okay, so that is in basically like chatbots are working today. So let's look a little bit more in the different frameworks which are available on the market. And of course, they are all, or most of them, are from the big cloud providers and machine learning in the cloud or machine learning as a service providers. They all have functions for chatbots and natural language recognition. And we try to put out the characteristics of these to distinguish them a little bit. So then, of course, Amazon AWS has a function called Amazon Lex. And you can build chatbots with this framework. Characteristics is they have text-based and also voice-based available. They claim they're using the Alexa technology, and probably you know Alexa. It's very advanced and very well working technology for voice recognition. It runs on Lambda server, serverless. This is nice, so you don't need huge servers 24 hours running. So that is, from the cost perspective, very efficient and nice. What is a big problem, in particular here in Germany, is it is only available in US English language. And this is kind of weird, because Alexa is available in a lot of different languages, certainly in German. But the Amazon Lex service at the moment is only available for English bot and English language and English speaking. And this is a problem for a lot of German speaking customers who want to use this. And it is quite restricted in terms of intents. So 100 intents is the maximum boundary here. I don't understand exactly why they have put it quite low, but that's the way Amazon Lex is working at the moment. Probably they will increase this, they will further develop this. They promised also to put other languages into that, but we haven't seen it until now. yeah, probably most probably the best known and one of the which is longest on the market is Dialogflow from Google. It was, I think, API Flow before this, and Google acquired that company. They are quite advanced. They are very easy to use, have a nice user interface. They are supporting up to 20 different languages, including Chinese, European languages, UK English, US English, and other stuff. What is also nice, a lot of connections to different channels, communication channels coming out of the box are there. For example, Alexa, Google Assistant, Slack, Facebook Messenger, and others. So you don't have to code it by hand. These are APIs ready to use. That is a nice thing. And of course, it runs on the Google Cloud platform. Then another platform is Microsoft Azure. Actually, they have two different services. They have the service LUIS. LUIS stands for Language Understanding System. And then another service, Bot Service. LUIS is for the intent recognition. Yeah, so that is only for, I put in a text, a written text, and then I recognize this is about, I don't know, booking, whatever it is about. That is something you can train. It works pretty well. It's very easy to train. You just put in these intents and hit the button. You can test it. You have APIs. So that's all nicely done. But it has no state control, no dialogue control, this kind of stuff. This is what the Azure Bot Service then brings with it. And this is something then you have to combine if you want to build a bot really with the dialogue structure. They have 7 languages available. What is nice, you can easily enhance it with additional AI services from Microsoft. This is nicely done. Like you can put in image recognitions, recommendations, translations, speech recognition, stuff like that. They also support a lot of different channels, email, GroupMe, Facebook, Messenger, of course, Microsoft Teams, and other things, Cortana, Skype, etc. Yeah, and of course, it runs on Microsoft Azure. A nice alternative is if you do not want to put your maybe sensible data, a user might be talk to a chatbot. For example, look, if you want to use it for your users, for your customers, and maybe they ask something for prices, contracts, stuff like this, or in the HR area, this is quite sensible data, and a lot of clients doesn't want to have that data on American cloud services, so they want to have it in-house in a restricted area. And this is exactly the solution Rasa is offering. Rasa was a startup in Berlin. Now it's already bigger. They got quite some capital. They are also now have offices in London and already a lot of employees. They're quite successful. And they have put together a tech stack of open source software from machine learning tools, what you need to build a chatbot. So all is Python-based. They use Google TensorFlow and Keras on top of that. You have different modules for the intent recognition, like Spacey or the Stanford library. So you can choose different libraries, plug them in, and build basically your own chatbot. And you can deploy it wherever you want. It runs on any Linux or Docker container on Linux server. So it can be run in-house on your servers. You can put it yourself in a cloud of your choice. So you are totally open and free to do that. You have the full control over the tech stack. And in-house solution is possible. Everything is open source, so it's very open to developers. You can really go down to the code and see things and change things. This is something you cannot do with Dialogflow and the others from the big cloud providers. You have a surface there, you can use the surface, but that's it. And here you can look into the code, everything is open sourced, and you can use that. You see, because of the different modules, you have more than 28 languages available because there are different modules for different languages which you can integrate. So you have quite some possibilities here. So we also tried that. One thing I want to stress here, that is the next step. Chatbot is not only a technical thing or less. Maybe the least thing is just the tech stack. That is, you see, very similar with the different chatbots. But what the user is seeing and experiencing is the personality of a chatbot, is the way a chatbot is doing a dialogue, the language a chatbot is using, the way he's interacting with the user, he's asking questions or is replying. Yeah, and this is a very, very important aspect for the usability and the success of a chatbot. And So the design of the chatbot, and with design we mean the dialogue design. It's not the optical or optical design. It's the dialogue design is really important for the success of the chatbots. So they are not only a technology, but they are a natural interface either to your clients or to your employees, whoever is the target group of your chatbot. And you should really make the choice and make it the personality and of the chatbot should really be in sync with your corporate identity. Yeah, it should really match it. So whatever company you are, the chatbot at that point is standing for your company. When a client is talking to your chatbot, he's talking to your company. And the way he receives the chatbot, this is the way he sees you as a company. So I give you a very, very bad example in my mind. That is a big German retailer, probably you all know, they're also here in Munich. They have built a chatbot as an Alexa skill. So it's a chatbot. For example, to have a shopping list, to order something. And when you talk to this chatbot, you basically talk to Alexa. And this is for a retailer, it's a very weird thing because first of all, Alexa is kind of dry and it's not the image of this retailer. He makes totally different advertising and positioning itself as a company. So this doesn't match at all. And Alexa get some combination with Amazon and which is a competitor for him. Yeah. So I think that is, one second, that is a quite bad choice if you just use an Alexa skill to build a chatbot for a retailer in Germany. Yeah, because this retailer didn't use Alexa Lex or Amazon Lex. With Amazon Lex, you can build your own chatbots. But for Alexa, you can develop in skills. Skills are like little apps inside Alexa. You say, Alexa, please do this and this, or open skill this and that. Yeah, so they are much more restricted. They're working in the Alexa environment, and they are available in German. Okay? Yeah, so I just want to say that is, in my mind, is a bad choice of an interface. And you can see how important the user interface is of a bot if you want to offer this to your clients. It's like a website. If you have a home page website for your company, this is the surface and the window of your company into the world. And a chatbot is exactly the same. So you really should take some thoughts and some work in how do you design the correct character and the dialogue of the chatbots. So how do you do this? This is an example how we did this with designers, actually, on our chatbot Baloo. And so we defined a character. What should be the character of Baloo? He's like a person, you know, he can be funny, he can be serious, he can be complicated, he can be whatever, like a human. And what we did, we defined these kind of sliders. So we said the bot or a person can be formal or informal, can be excited or can be calm, can be loud, can be quiet, helpful, and so on and so on. And then in a workshop, we discussed this and we tried it with users and with our designers. And at the end, we said, okay, that is something, this should be the personality of our chatbot. So he should be between formal and informal, not too formal, but for example, he should be joking, more joking than serious. He should be really helpful and not non-helpful. That is what a bot is about. We discussed, should it be a first person, like mimicking a person, I'm a person, I have a name, or should it make it clear, hey, I'm a robot. Yeah. So we decided we should not fool people, it's clear that it is a robot. And he should say, hey, I'm a chatbot, I'm a robot. That is, for example, when you ask Siri or Alexa or whatever, are you really a robot? Then they say, of course I'm a robot. Yeah. So that's exactly the same thing. Concise, not verbose, etc. So that is some discussion you should do together with your design people. with your designers, with UX experts, with maybe customers or users of the bot to do this discussion and define that. So then there comes some personality out. You should give it the name and maybe even some visual so that you have an icon or a picture, whatever. So this even gives it more character. And so for Baloo, we said it should be simple language, but concise, helpfully proactive, and of course it's a robot. Just some of the characteristics. And this stuff helps you in the development of the bot. Because then you go and you have to design, this is just more in detail the definition we came up of the bot. So we said focus on comprehension, abilities, ease of use. The bot's communication is balanced text, clear, unambiguous, and helpful. Expanding the training data for intents to understand different ways the user could say the same thing, and so on. At the last point, Baloo is a chatbot, not a human. And Baloo is completely aware of this, not fooling others. So if you have this, then this is really helpful to define the different dialogues, intents, and texts the bots is creating. And this is some now starts the programming. This is just an example. It's a text file or different text files I have put together here on the screen. If you can read this on the left side, you define the intents. What are the different intents for your chatbot? What should the chatbot be able to do? So we have intents to greet. The chatbot should say hello. What can I help you? Some nice words if you start working with the bot. He should be able to say goodbye in a nice way, like a human. He should say thank you, or I'm sorry, I'm not able to do this. Or these are my skills, I can do this and this, but nothing else. How are you? Some nice small talk before you start really the real thing, what you want to do. Are you a robot? Would be a question. A lot of people asking just because they are curious how the robot would react. Leave then the real business intents. Leave annual total, leave annual left, leave annual taken, planned, the list of the planned, cancellation, taken, what are public holidays, confirmation. So these are the real intents you need for your business processes in this case. Deny, done, insult, and maybe some random jokes at the end. Yeah, so you define these intents, and then you see in the middle layer, for each intent, you write real text which should be recognized as this intent. For example, if the customer says, hi, hello, hi there, moin, good morning, whatever, this is the intent greeting. So that means the user is greeting the bot, and the bot should reply in a nice way. Say, yeah, hello, hi, I'm the bot. And the output, well, then the next thing is the dialogues. This is just an excerpt here on the right side. So for example, if you recognize the intent goodbye, then you say utter goodbye, you say goodbye, then you ask for feedback, utter feedback. Does the user want to give you some feedback, how his experience was, and then maybe a confirmation. So these steps, it's like a programming language, are the dialogues. What are the different steps you go through for each intent? And this is used in the dialogue control to ask for these different things. At another point, it's not here on this screen, you also define the different entities. For example, to book vacations, you have to know the start and the end of the vacations and then number of days in between. Yeah, these are the entities which the bot has to fill in the dialogues. That is another step which is not on the screen here. And then at the end, the output of the bot is simply, as I said, it's templates of text you define. So for example, if you have the utterance goodbye, you have two texts. One is bye-bye, one is goodbye and enjoy your day. Yeah, and the bot is then randomly choosing the one or the other to have some variety in his output. So very simple. So that is the way you define the intents, the dialogues, and the utterance of the bot. And another step is you define the dialogues. And here this is the dialogue tree. You define it in the first place as a dialogue tree. And these are the different stories or intents the bot can do. Yeah, that's maybe a little bit small to read. Feel free on the printouts later to have a look at this. But these are the different actions the bot is able to do. And then you jump back to the beginning and ask for the next thing. Then you train the bot on this, and you have several training steps. The first thing is training the intents. And here you usually work with word embeddings, for example, like a word to vec. And these are stuff which is pre-trained. You don't train from scratch. These are, you can download it on the internet by Google and by others, so that the words are already mapped to in a multi-dimensional space, and similar words are mapped to similar spaces. And an utterance is just a sequence of these points in this space. And similar utterances are mapped to similar trajectories. So that is then easy to understand. And all what you do is, as you've seen in the training set, you define the different sentences which should be mapped to one utterance, and then you train the bot additionally after this pre-training to recognize these intents. And that works very well, at least for written text. That works really nicely, and as I said, up to 100 intents is really no problem, and you have a very high accuracy. What is a problem sometimes is, especially for speech recognition, is special domain problems. Because all the frameworks you have seen and you found pre-trained on the internet are trained on general domain language. So languages we are talking, stuff you find on the internet. But for example, we worked with a client who have built a bot for a laboratory. So he wanted to help doctors and people working in a medical or pharmaceutical laboratory to work hands-free. And he, instead of writing notes, they wanted to dictate it into a bot. And they had a lot of problems because they're using a lot of terminology which is specific for this domain. And this terminology is not included in the general pre-learned identifiers or networks. And you cannot add additional vocabulary to the normal Azure and Amazon and Google recognition engines. So you are not able to add your own vocabulary onto this. So then you have to work with custom-built recognition and recognition and your own networks, yeah, which is a lot more effort here. So that can cause problems. Then for the dialogues, that is a different story. So either you use a decision tree, yeah, that is usually done. This is static, there's no training required, you just define the tree. If you want to use neural networks for this, LSTMs, for example, then you have to train them, and this is tricky because you don't have a lot of training examples. You only have one version of a dialogue, or maybe two, three versions of a dialogue, but not thousands of different versions of a dialogue. They just don't exist. And of course, the problem is the chatbot do not really has an understanding of what you are talking about. Yeah, so he just tries to figure out the state and the intent, and then the next action. Some people are trying in the research field to use reinforcement learning to do this, yeah, where you need a strategy, you have a goal, you want to finish this dialogue, you need some knowledge from the user to fill in your entities, and you are in a certain state. So this is really very close to reinforcement learning. But again, the training example is the problem. So you have as a user to work with the bot in these dialogues and say, this was a good thing, you did the task, very well done, so you get a positive feedback, or you say, well, you screwed up, you asked totally wrong things and you have not been able to ask me the right things and to finish the dialogue, so you get a negative feedback. And this you have to do over and over again, and you know, with reinforcement learning, you talk about thousands or even millions of trainings, so this is really impractical. And you cannot simulate that. An autonomous driving car you can simulate. You have all the cameras from drives which you can use. But in case of chatbots, well, maybe you can record already dialogues which the user has done. People are trying to do this, playing a chatbot. They call it the Wizard of Oz approach, where the user thinks he works with a chatbot, but in reality there's a human behind the wall, and then they're noting everything. That is an approach. But in general, this training stuff is not really working pretty well. So usually people are using simple decision trees for the dialogue model. Yeah, but another aspect is testing. So you all know how to test software, and we have a lot of experience. This is automated. Let's look here. This is the general test pyramid, as you call it. So and you try to automate this stuff. So you start with the unit test, what you have developed, then you have an integration test and end-to-end tests. So, but in case of a chatbot, you don't have a clear definition what is a good dialogue, what is not a good dialogue. So you cannot automate dialogues testing, right? You might have, if you're, you put in the state you are, you have an unlimited historical state combinations, whatever happened before that dialogue and is taken into consideration by the bot, if it is, for example, trained with LSTMs. So therefore, you have to do at least some of these end-to-end tests, user tests manually by end users. We call this exploratory testing, just to play around with the bot and see how he behaves with different inputs. And then what is also really important is when the bot is in operation, to monitor it closely and see what is the input by users and how the bot is reacting on that. Maybe you find out that your end users are putting totally different text in this or stated in a different way, asking in a different way, using different words you have not been thinking about when you trained the bot, right? So therefore, we are not talking about a training pyramid. We more talk about a test table. So we start with the unit test. That is something, of course, when you are a developer, you can automate that. These are the classical unit tests. Then comes the integration test, so the different components. That's also something you can automate with test tools and pipelines, etc. And then comes the machine learning test. So, for example, the error rate, the recognition rate, the confusion matrix. These are things, for example, how well do you recognize the intents? Example, that is something you also can automate. So you train your models and then you test it on an independent test set and then calculate, well, the recognition rate or the confusion matrix between different intents. But then comes the exploratory testing. This again, the effort is much higher. That is something only users can do, and this means end users or you are sitting in front of the bot and then working with the bot, playing with it, talking to it, and see how the bot really behaves. And maybe finding new errors or things he screws up or he finished the dialogue in the wrong way, etc. And then, last but not least, that is even bigger, is monitoring and the user data analysis. So when the bot is maybe in a pre-production phase with limited users, or maybe your colleagues or friends, monitoring it, log in the data and see what people are putting into the bot, how the bot is behaving on that, and maybe using these dialogues again for training to get more training data and then augment the training data and improve the performance of the bot. One last aspect, we're good in time, is continuous delivery for chatbots. You probably know from software development what is continuous delivery, continuous integration. This is an approach where you try to automate your development processes, deployment processes, and test processes to deploy developments very fast in little chunks, more or less automatically tested into production. And this is something what also is important for chatbots, because you want to train it continuously, you get feedback from your users, you monitor how the bot is behaving in reality, you do some retraining, you add words to the training set, do some retraining, and then you have to deploy it again. And this is something you do continuously, maybe on a daily basis, on a weekly basis, whatever. Maybe if you're a big customer, maybe on an hourly basis, whatever. So we have done this with our bot in this way. This is just one example, how you can do this development environment with different pipelines. So this is for our Baloo bot based on the Rasa technology. We had the source code and the data sets, so the training data sets, dialogue data sets, and we put everything on GitHub, because the training data is quite small. You have seen the different dialogues and intents, so this is a couple of kilobytes, not even megabytes, so that is easy to do the versioning in GitHub. If you have huge data, which probably is not the case for chatbots, but for other machine learning stuff, you cannot put them to GitHub, then you use different tools. But in our case, GitHub was fine. So whenever something changed in GitHub and we checked it into GitHub, then the pipeline was started and then we had a build process and we did the unit test of the software. testing like test-driven development, testing it against our test scripts. We had an integration test, and we also had some security checks because it was applied outside of our firewall. Then we could evaluate the models, the machine learning models, after the training. And here we calculated the confusion matrix. We checked different other metrics, like recognition rate, and looking if they are below some threshold that would stop the whole process and would give an alarm or a note. But if they are still above a threshold, the whole process went further automatically. We persisted the model in our case in S3, deployed it for STAVE on the staging area, and then we had this deploy production, and this was the manual button. So before hitting that button and really deploy it to the production, we did our user testing, and then on the staging area we played with the bot. We see how it behaves. Was it really okay? We checked some different dialogues, and if everything was okay, we hit the button and then it was deployed to the users. If not, if something went wrong, we could stop it and then start the process again, or restore the older version. Yeah, so you can really, really automate this process, but still you have some manual stuff in between. Okay, so yeah, that was an overview about the different bots. Let's just summarize this last slide. As you've seen, there's a lot of rapid process going on in the scientific area in terms of natural language processing and research, and we really think this will really increase the power of bots and the purpose and for which the broadening of the bots, not only for specific areas but for much broader areas, will really increase the possibilities bots will play in the future. Getting the training data in sufficient amount and in quality is a big problem. Yeah, so you have to design it by hand, or you play a bot as a human, like Wizard of Oz, and then create this kind of dialogues. But still, this is a big problem to get this data. They have really to be manually created. Then it's very important that the chatbot in production has to be continuously monitored, so that it is not that is really reacting in the way you have planned this with your end users. And last but not least, the interface, the design of the user design of the chatbot is really important. So the bot is not just a technical tool in your IT; it is the user interface to your end users, to your customers, employees, whoever, and you really should take this into account and design the bot in this way. Okay, then I think I'm done with this. Yeah, thank you very much for your attention. Are there any questions? Yeah. Yeah. I would 40,000 intents, that's a totally different model, right? So what are the 40,000 different things you want to do with the chatbot? This is a general assistant, probably, where you can talk about almost everything, I would imagine. I think then you need a different technology to do this. Then it's not simply intent recognition and this is the way I'm handling intents. And you cannot maintain for 40,000 intents this kind of dialogues and the slots, etc. Then I think you need a completely different approach to do that. Yeah, from 100 to 400, that's maybe something you can do. You have to check how good is the recognition still, what is the confusion matrix, how close are these intents.
And do you specifically use RASA as a technology?
No, that is very client-specific. It depends really on our clients. Some clients say we are strategically using Microsoft, for example, then we do Azure. Others say we want to have the data in-house, we use RASA. This really depends on the clients, it has to be decided.
Okay.
I don't know if they ask you and how to do that. We could do a comparison, but this would be some thorough work. What I think is they are not that far apart, and usually they are not choosing what is really the best platform. And you know, the platforms are really changing very fast. So if you measure the performance today, maybe next week or in a month, it can be different picture.
I can tell you that IBM Watson and Google Dialogflow are performing really well.
Yeah. Lower, okay.
Yeah, okay. It's something you can use as an advice.
Yeah, okay, thank you. What we see that the customers have different reasons why they go with Microsoft, for example. Because they do everything with Microsoft, they have a strategic partnership. So they don't ask, is Google maybe a little bit better or IBM, right? So we haven't really, not really compared this platform in depth. We haven't done that. Okay. In the back, yeah. The preferred what? The preferred? No. This depends on the use case. And for example, in terms of our bot, our employees prefer the chat platform because we do a lot with chat and especially with Google Chat inside our enterprise. So that is very convenient that with a mobile phone, they just can ask for some vacations, just hitting a message, right? But this can be totally different. Young people usually use Facebook and use the Facebook Messenger. Maybe others taking Slack in the technical environment. Or you want to speech, you need your hands for different things. Then you have some oral conversations. That is very much dependent on the use case. The question was, what is preferred, text or voice? That also depends on the use case. So a lot of people prefer text because they are so applied, used to text messaging, right? But for example, in this use case for working in a laboratory where you don't have your hands or a doctor, he of course prefers voice. Yeah, so that depends also on the use case. You have a question? Yeah. Sometimes it's integrated in the framework. For example, Lewis has this typo correction automatically built in. You can switch it off if you like. The others, I'm not sure. This really depends. But usually, they have some way to handle with typos. Also, capital letters, small letters, this kind of stuff. This is done as some kind of pre-processing of the input text. With what? With?
With the dialogue.
With the dialogue.
Because normally there is not a lot of database about.
Yes.
Have you never tried to use like a old system, like a short discussion by email that normally is something database that you can integrate with?
For training? But this is. Yeah. We haven't done this. I know that people sometimes take WhatsApp content and try to train bots on this. The problem is the domain. You build the bot for a certain domain, for example, vacation requirements. And then you need dialogues on this specific topic, right? And dialogues which how you use the bot, and email is usually a different kind of dialogue, because you're writing, some time goes until you get a response. So that is the question, how well this fits. But it could be a try, definitively.
Another question, because it's just going now the problem on the language. Normally there are kind of a solution to do a pipeline. So normally you take like a model that do interpolation and then you use your chatbot. Have you tried that?
Yeah.
And I use the chatbot for doing from
Ah, and you translate into a different language first. No, we haven't tried that. That might be a possibility, but it will get the performance, probably get it down, because translation is not perfect. Yeah, you have the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. We haven't tried that, so I have no experience how this works. Yeah. You have a question?
What are the biggest challenges for a company which wants to buy or develop a chatbot?
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
What's your suggestion?
one really of the I think most important advice is taking this design of the bot into account. A lot of companies are not doing this. They see it as a technical stuff. You have to very well define your domain. So have it restricted as possible. Then the bot works much better. But then maybe it's getting bored or you cannot do everything what you want to do. So finding the right use case is really a challenge. For example, companies say, I want to do my first level support with bots. But this is a huge area and it's really hard to build a bot who can understand all this stuff. And then people are really getting frustrated. They try the bot and it's not really answering in the correct way. And then the people getting frustrated. So finding this exactly use case and a very much defined area to use that bot, particularly when you start with this development, I think that is the biggest challenge for companies. Yeah. Okay, I would say we are on top of the hour. Thank you very much again for your attention. I'm here on this conference, so whenever you have more questions or want to have a chat with me, feel free to approach me. Thank you very much.